event, so this is our third event this week. The whole purpose of this week is to try to get people's ideas, their hopes, their aspirations. We're trying to get local knowledge, local information about the Riverway, how people want to use it, how we best connect to it. So we've been running a series of events. We started off with a potential cooch night on Tuesday. I see a few of our speakers are here. That was a quick way to get ideas. We've had two listen and learn events, one with the river users. So Coleman Byrne is here, who gave a presentation on behalf of the Limerick Open Navigation Group. We also have Dave Neville from NevSail telling us what it was like to be a business owner on the river, trying to run a business on the river. We had a community mapping workshop in which we had people with disabilities auditing the public space. We also had Chinatowns groups and the Purple Flag groups and environmental groups and cyclists and heritage groups just giving us feedback about the their ideas about the area. So tonight is our listen and learn event, and it's about policies on the river. So we've invited two speakers, and I'm going to let Magella O'Brien, who's our tourism officer. Magella is going to moderate the event. So she'll introduce the speakers. The idea is that they get a half an hour to describe from their perspective their approach to Limerick's riverways. And then we open up the floor for 15 minutes of discussion. And so we have to begin with, we have Josephine, and let Magella start off proceedings. And all I'm going to do is give you guys deadlines, just so that we keep on time. And I'll also bring around the microphone, so when we have questions.
Okay, thanks, Rosie. Welcome, everybody, as Rosie said. Josephine is our first speaker tonight. Josephine O'Driscoll is the Wild Atlantic Manager with Water Ireland. Josephine is based in Cork, and she briefly worked as the Client Service Manager with the Cork section of the Wild Atlantic Way. So,
thank you very much. I'm going to stand here, I call them, stand up all behind big screen there I'm talking to. So, good evening, everybody. It's lovely to see you. Such a big number in the room here this evening. I'm here, not a Cork woman coming up to tell Limerick what to do, definitely not. But I'm here, I suppose, in the role I work on the Wild Atlantic Way. But one of the other things that I do when working on the Wild Atlantic Way is that I've been involved in the last while in looking and developing what we call our visitor experience development framework. So what do I mean by that? It's very much looking at how we develop experiences for people, whether it's local people, whether it's local visitors, domestic visitors, international visitors, in terms of the way that they are now consuming experiences and the way that we should be looking at Limerick in terms of developing experiences in your beautiful city or and in the rivers and in the waters that you have surrounding Limerick City. And I suppose over the last while there's been very much a collaborative approach between Faulty Ireland and the Council in terms of looking at a framework for how Limerick could start to think about how they should consider the use of their waterways here in Limerick, in the city and the environment. And I suppose the rationale behind a lot of that was, if I ask a question, how many people here in the room have booked holidays for the summer? Maybe a few people have booked. So when you started to look at your holidays and started thinking about your holidays, one of the things that you started to think about was the destination that you wanted to go to. And for some of you, it was very much about what do you want to do and see within the area. I know for some of you, it's sunshine, it's sit down, enjoy the sunshine, and that's it. But there's an awful lot of you here inside the room that you think that from a cultural perspective, from a historical perspective, that there are things that you want to see and do to learn about the destination that you want to go. So when you're thinking about where you would like to go, think about the visitors and what they would like to think about Limerick and why they would want to choose Limerick as a destination, a must-see that they would want to see within Limerick and its environs. And I suppose it's providing that visitor with both cultural, educational opportunities that will allow them to immerse themselves here in the cities, whether it's on the land or whether it is on the water, in terms of getting a very good historical, cultural, vibrant experience and a memorable experience here. But it's something that can be created through festival and events that will allow the visitor to create those memories that they will have when they go back into their home places. And what we need to think about about when we're looking at Limerick in terms of what are the stories about Limerick? And I'll show you some kind of things that have come through. But you yourself, think of a visitor, kind of think of the stories that they will hear and when they're actually looking at Limerick, looking at the themes around Limerick in terms of your vibrant culture, your history. Look at it in terms of what your waterways have to offer, the culture, the history, and how can you create a memorable experience for your visitor. We've done an awful lot of thinking, and if you think of the visitor over the last number of years, the visitor that is coming in to any destination, Ireland is a little island in a whole kind of area in terms of the full worldwide scale, in terms of people choosing a destination, in terms of looking at what people want to come and see. So when you think of Ireland, that tiny lot in terms of the competitiveness of what we want to do. And if we think of the way that visitors, you yourself, put yourself in the visitor's shoes, when you actually look at whether you're doing a city destination, a weekend break, what you're doing, what you want to go and do and see, you're not going for the product. The hotel doesn't make you decide that's where I want to go from. The Art Hotel is one of those very posh five-star memorable experiences, but ultimately, it's the destination, what you can do, what you can see, will make you choose a destination. So when we talk about an experience, we think of it, it's about an event that changes the way that you look at the world. And it's something that makes you feel, it's something that makes you think. And the experts will tell you, kind of through a lot of research, that people are now looking to go for experiences rather than consume hours when they go on a holiday and they want to go to a destination. So when we look at that, and you think of some of the experiences that you've had on holidays, so when you talk and you've had a great time when you're on holidays, one of the things that you do, you take a picture, you'll put it on Facebook, you'll put it on kind of through, you know, whatever social media channel that you want. What's the first thing you do? You'll tell all of your friends and family about the wonderful experience that you had on holiday. And that would be your memorable experience. When you're thinking about what are the memorable experiences that the visitor can have when they're here in Limerick, through their experiences on the land and on the water that are here, through your history and through your culture. And I showed this recently at a conference that I was at, and this is what makes it very memorable and creates an emotional connection. So if you look at that picture, there's three very different people in that picture. You all recognise one of them, the Queen. And when she was here a number of years ago, it was a very memorable experience that has been shown worldwide in terms of her connection with the people of Ireland. The person on the left looking at you is a fishmonger in the English market in Cork City, and the person behind is a politician. So for each one of them, it was an emotional connection in terms of memorable experience, in terms of what they do. And when we think about what we're looking to do kind of through Fort Ireland to attract visitors to our destination, it is about developing compelling experiences that will connect with the visitor, will want them to connect with your area, your destination, and you will want them to go away and feeling very satisfied. But that can only be done by developing an experience that has a compelling story at its heart. When you look at the Limerick here, and you look at the rivers that you have here, you look at the museum, which is a fantastic museum that we're in tonight, you know, King John's Castle, to name a few of the fantastic historical and cultural assets that you have in the city. And you look at that product and you look in terms of how can you develop an experience that will be compelling for the visitor. Because the ultimate aim of developing visitor experiences here in the Limerick area is very much about developing the economic value of what tourism is worth to you here. And in terms of motivating visitors to stay here, creating employment, and that will ultimately lead to kind of an economic development here in the area. And I suppose when we think of that and we look at it, I just put it in the experience spectrum here in terms of Limerick, looking at it. You have Limerick, you have the waterways here in Limerick, you have the rivers. You have St. John's Castle here. One of the services that's provided within the castle are guided tours, but what does the visitor leave them feeling with? They learn about the history of the castle. They learn about how people live there, and they actually get the look and feel of it. There were some of the actors dressed up here a moment ago. So they're living the living history of here in the Hunt Museum. And that's what the visitor will remember when they're actually leaving in terms of the visitor experience. When we look at who is looking to look at kind of visitor experiences here in the Limerick area and the destination, we have three market segments that we involve Ireland. And Ireland itself is when we look at the culturally curious, each one of us would fit into one of these three brands in terms of from a visitor perspective. What do you look for when you go away? When you think of the culturally curious, they're probably those that have an awful lot of time in their house. They like to come to a destination and they like to experience it, more than likely kind of as a couple, kind of, you know, maybe two or three couples or maybe kind of a family that want to go. They want to find authentic experiences, learn about the history, the culture of the area, meet with the locals who can tell them the story of those areas. They also want to have everything accessible to them. They do quite a lot of research before they come on holiday here, but in terms of being here, they want to have rich cultural experiences. They want to feel that they're very authentic, and they also want to go and find them for themselves. They don't necessarily need a guide, but they're the type of people who like to stay somewhere nice and meet somewhere nice. And when you look at what you have in terms of your accommodation stock and what the walks that you have here, the river that you have here, the history and culture that they can assume, it is fantastic. You then have what we call our great escaper. And this is very much about if you think of your family and if you think of those that want to go away and they want to reconnect as a family. They want to do things together, so it's very much maybe multi-generational, or it could be a family. We were talking about your young 14-month-old daughter. It's about you going away and connecting with your family, with your, you know, when you're on holiday. Doing things together as a family. So think about here in Limerick, in your waterways. What do you have on your waterways, on your walkways, here in the city, that a family can consume and enjoy together if they're here in Limerick? And then we have our group, which are social. Social energizers. I want to say I'm possibly going past that social energizer stage, but they are the ones that want to go away and they really want to be energized. They want to be going away to the festival and events. You probably see an awful lot of them. Is it Great Limerick Run weekend on this weekend? You probably have a lot of social energizers here that want to come away in groups to do something that is energetic, that is entertaining, but also that they will be entertained when they are here as well. And you have, like, you have the food markets over here this weekend, so they will feel energized going back after what they've done. So in terms of, there was some work done a number of years ago in terms of looking at Limerick and looking at the tourism proposition. And it was very much in terms of where heritage, culture, and nature flow together. And it very much looked at Limerick, the city and the environment that it was here. And it looked at very much it, very much the rivers and waters that were here. And it was all about discover, explore, experience, and get active. And each one of those things were broken down into the different stories that can bring these to life. And it's very much about discover the history and the heritage that Limerick has to offer. Explore through the knowledge, through the enterprise, and through the trade that was done in the past, that is being done now, and what can be done in the future. So it's very much looking at this as very much an enterprising town. In terms of how many universities do you have here? Colleges?
Three.
How many other areas, you know, can boast that level of a knowledge bank that is available to people within the area? And in terms of the trade that was done through the waterways here in your city, kind of in the past and in the present. Look at the creativity in terms of your literature, your arts, your design, and your food culture that you have here. So think of all of those in terms of what the visitor will experience when they come in here to Limerick and how they will achieve that. And of course, get active, I suppose, the home of Foman Park, kind of, you know, come to more in terms of nature and sport and recreation. I suppose Limerick, a bit like Cork, we can't be holding our hands up very high kind of at present time, but our time will come again within our sports and our recreation. So I'm going to show you something that was done a number of years ago. It's going to be, it's not my work. It's the work of an architect by Dennis Byrne and Alan Sherwood, who did put together some thoughts, and they were only thoughts kind of, you know, that came back kind of as a result of consultation that was done. But what I want you to think about when you start looking at this, will this bring the waterway, the rivers kind of upending to life for the visitor? And if they were to do kind of, you know, by bringing the waterways to life, I think we were talking about earlier on that if I was a visitor coming in to Limerick, how can I find my way in terms of wayfinding around Limerick City if I want to walk around and experience the beautiful paths that you have around the waterways at the moment? If I'm a visitor, can I easily find and consume what I want to do on the water? Kind of, you know, through kind of, do you have kayaking on the water? So if I'm a visitor coming in, is it easily consumed? Can I easily find it? So that's what you have to think of in terms of the villages. Does every one of the concierge, the front of line office staff of every hotel within the area know what to do and see within the area? Who are your characters within the city? And if you all have characters that can bring stories to life, who are these characters? So they want to meet the real people, whether it's a pub when they're listening to music, whether it's through listening to kind of culture, song, dance videos. Who are they? Do you bring them to the forefront? There's somebody being pointed to there as a character. We probably have a number of them here. But if I'm a visitor coming into the city, if I find a visitor coming in, do I find that person easy? Do I hear the music? Do I hear the history, traditions, the culture by truly authentic people kind of in the area? And how can visitors experience Limerick here on the land and on the river? So when we're looking at developing compelling experiences to go into the shop window that can be sold both domestically and internationally, think of all of these things. And I'm going to ask Rosie to help me also in terms of presenting some of Dennis's work. In terms of what his ideas were when he looked at the river. So forgive me, I have to read his notes because without those, you can see that they're very hard to understand when you look at the visuals. Does it make you know what I said?
Both Dennis and Eanna, I apologize, they wouldn't have liked to have been here this evening, but it just clashed with yours.
Absolutely. So they would have done an awful lot of work. So very much, when we're looking at this slide here, this, I go for, this is very much kind of an overall project in the context of the waterways that are here within Limerick. And when we look at that, he is looking at this here, and unfortunately, there was a black background to these, and I might actually change it over to the black, so it might be easier if you don't, if you don't mind just to, for you to see, and I won't bump my head in this. Make it a little better, easier to read. And I'm going to have to grab the possibly grab. Okay, so this is very much about the aerial view of Limerick and the waterways as it stands at the moment. This is a historic map, and it's showing the importance of King's Island and the two rivers. And all from the edges of what is key to the Abbey River are man-made, and some more recent than others. So as you can see, you have from 1590 right through there to 1840, and you can see how the rivers have been developed, kind of man-made development over time. We then have some aerial views, and you can see that in the first one, kind of between, where it was built, anyone tell me, history lesson as well, when was the weir built in the river?
The weir, this is about the weir across from the island.
Across from the island. 2000 to 2007. And this partial, you can see in the picture here, is the partial construction in 2000, and as it moves along, there's an aerial construction there of what it was up until 2007. And this forms the wall across the river. And this separates over time. I'm the expert, the non-expert telling you, the experts in the room, but this is in terms of the tidal water from the river water, except when the tide is high in the Mingo. The fact that this river structure exists can be used as an opportunity to complete the riverside walkway. Connection by piggybacking on what is already there and connecting to the walkway provided three quarters of the way around the river. And the foundations are already there, so they are free. So when we look at that, and then we move on to the next one. And this is an historical map from 1829. And this shows a river walk along the line of the weir. The map by the Inland Stream Navigation Company shows an historic desire for connection. The river channel will have one dynamic and the floating dock. Side creating a calmer water would always be full of water. In closed docks like in London, St. Catherine's Dock made it possible to have a green and water-related activities. Also at the Dock in Dublin, at the Docklands. This was a crucial social document giving historical validity and back up their thinking reassured. And I think what we've seen here, this is pre-2001, the West Bank heard walkway then on the East Bank, and it was difficult to navigate. In post-2001, the wall was built across the river, and then Longford, the place where the original Viking harbour was. And a proposed building on the Weir and another front, the Longford to the City Hall, not in front of the castle, coming into the river, not interfering with the historic relationship of the castle.
So, what he was saying was that the proposal was to build on the Weir, because there was a structure there already, and then to connect across, so not in the Weir, but to build on top of the Weir, that was the original proposal.
Well, is there a structure there already, or was it just on that?
No, he's saying basically that
it's existing now,
so they saw it as an opportunity to connect the three-quarters way around with a more direct route than the one that is
These are ideas.
Nothing has gone anywhere. There was an idea that put forward by Jens.
Just a point of that, you didn't say it, so...
Thank you very much indeed for clarifying.
They're ideas, not plans.
They are very much ideas. Very, very much. And when you see them down further, you absolutely and categorically kind of make sure that they are ideas. This was a report that was done by an architect called Dinsmore, and it was done in conjunction with Alan Sherwood, that was put together. It was funding that was given together at the time by Limerick Council, Shannon Development and Failte Ireland. So they are a few years old. So in terms of looking at it, it was a proposal at that time. And it's just now looking at it again. It's something that could be considered. There's nothing there. But it's ideas of how the waterways could be awakened in
it. It was a tourism proposition and interpretive framework that was commissioned. Think about how the visitors...
Are tourists really consuming by water or tourists really by water?
It doesn't make any difference. Okay. It's when they're in Limerick, what they can do when they're in Limerick.
So I'll give you guys an opportunity for questions just so you can...
And look, these are all, and I'm going to flip through them very quickly. It probably makes sense that these were all ideas of what they were looking and proposing for walkways along the river that would connect both of the rivers, that would make it kind of a circular walkway for them kind of coming through, kind of when they were there. So that is it. Important buildings, and it's connecting it, and it's very much thinking of it in terms of how it would make the river very navigational for the visitor when they were here in the city. So
we're just relaying the information about how this is thought about as a way of activating the edges, allowing for the interpretation of both the potential for gang plans to be intensified, so he's saying basically there's a line through which things can be filled in and activated behind it. But I think really the idea was that you'd have a kind of domesticated water on the one side, which would allow for this kind of safer environment for activities to happen than a more dynamic side of the time.
I noticed that the
larger
city road and the
smaller
starts to be
tested
as well.
There are a few.
Some of you have been to these cities kind of before, and
If you look at the waterfront there in Seattle, kind of, they have maximized the potential of kind of making waterways available to the local visitors along the way. San Antonio River Walk, kind of built in the 1930s, and this was very much kind of, you know, allowing the people to have access to the water that's on their doorstep. One of the concepts that they came to together was looking at it in the terms of liquid light, and this was very much kind of a proposal and an idea that was put forward in relation to the illumination of bridges, kind of at the waterways, kind of, you know, around Limerick here. And it's very much about looking at it clearly calmly, and it was inspired by the cities, and it looked at what was taking place in the cities in Belfast, in Germany, and in Derry, and how they kind of, you have to think of the visitors well during the day and night. They don't go to sleep at 8 o'clock and then forget about what they're doing. After they leave, they want other things to do and see. But by bringing your city to life, and this is one of the ideas that they had of bringing the city to life by calling it the liquid light. And it was very much in terms of lighting up the different bridges and highlighting the differences between the waters that were there. And sometimes making sure that you can see the difference between what is the weir and how, you know, the different waters that are on your that are on your river. And it's all about kind of the dynamic movement of the water being brought to life by the light on the river. And it looked at it in terms of kind of building in kind of very looking at it from a very sustainable and environmentally protected manner as well, in terms of making sure that what was being done was very sensitive to the environment, in terms of low lighting underneath the bridges that were there in existence. And it's looking at theatrical lighting among the area. It's looking at how can you deck out the light and using kind of amber lights, LED lighting, to make sure that the amber light kind of, as you're walking along the river, is brought to light. And these will be, again, environmentally sustainable, biologically and solar powered, and you're looking at it there. Just in terms of, these are the architect's drawings in terms of having the light lit from underneath and having shadows created on the water as you're walking through. It's very much about between water, the weir and water's key, looking at it as a lagoon and how can you bring that to life through lighting within the whole area that you have there. One of the things that they looked at was looking at how they could make use of the water, kind of creating arcs of light kind of coming up from the water and from the bridges, and creating kind of these illuminated light structures through water as well as you're going through. And it's in terms of using the pressurized water to kind of create these arcs, not completely drawing people, making it as an experience for people in terms of jet waters along the areas as well, and using light as the installation that will bring the fountains, that will bring the bridges together and offer a different experience for the visitors during the nighttime experiences, and do that in an urban space. So that is very much in terms of ideas that were put forward in terms of looking at that. But aside from all of that, it's looking at thinking about your waterways and thinking it from the visitor's perspective. You have a fantastic system here in Limerick. Is it being utilised to its full capacity for the locals, for the visitors alike? And how can we do that? That we're developing compelling experiences for the visitors to enjoy in their own Limerick. Thank you.
I'm also a big fan of the idea of opening up the edge of the river, as I think and the accessibility, as I suspect most people are in the room. But it's very interesting to see those drawings. I was aware of their existence. And I've often used the analogies myself with floating swimming pools and access to ridges, to edges and decks and beaches. But some of the examples involved, like Austin and a few of the others, and Seattle, they're not directly comparable, because most of them, to my best of my knowledge, deal with the edge of the river. Whereas the ideas of the bridges here are quite ambitious, very ambitious structurally, and a much wider river in a much different microclimate. So I would be concerned about the relevance and also the strength of the historical setting of the edges of our river that we have here. It is a pleasure to walk along them. And I would like to see us opening them up in the way that they are, so you can simply use them without having to do an enormous amount of expenditure and infrastructure. So I think there are simpler and more elegant ways of doing it. And there may be a case for bridges, occasionally, or promontories or piers, but the kind of scale of what's being suggested here, I'd have some concerns about its correct, its suitable affinity to the history of the waterfront of the city.
Representing a significant portion of the river users, and I think we had this discussion yesterday as well, but most of these ideas that are presented at the moment would ineffectively, they would close the navigation of the river, and they would block off the nice as they might be for people walking on the river, but they would completely close the river from navigation, from boat users, from its natural maritime use, and so on and so forth. So while we're all in favour of, all of the group are in favour of finding suitable ways of bringing people onto the river, into the river, and under the river, and whatever we want to call it, you know, most of those ideas would prevent that, in my opinion, except for walkers, people walking around. So there are a lot more uses of the river than walking around it. You know, we have two commercial on the river, using the river every day for canoeing, paddleboarding, kayaking, and it's lovely to see all the people out in the middle in the pool, and any of those activities would prevent a lot of that. It would also prevent most navigation from anybody coming in from the estuary or coming down from the Loch Derg. It would close the river. So I think we need to find different areas. Okay? I appreciate that. I appreciate that these are ideas, which is why I was trying to make a point.
Exactly.
I appreciate
that.
Take
the conversation. But I suppose, can I just answer that just in one sense? Well, kind of, they were ideas that were presented a number of years ago.
I don't
quite
so.
Right.
So now there is a little bit of a different.
No, and I suppose you've raised something that is hugely valid there in terms of the way that people are now using the waterways, and not going to steal, you know, anybody's thumb in terms of. But it is the most fantastic opportunity, and we possibly haven't made the most of what our people can do looking at the water and how they can enjoy the water as well.
I certainly agree with you that we haven't made the best use or the most use of our jewel in our crown, and that is the river.
Yeah.
And there's things we can do to make it much more accessible and much more useful and much more attractive.
Hi, my name is Lucia. I'm a designer. I have a studio based on the Bishop Street, which is just off the Nicola Street. And I would just want to point out in regards to the river, I think the ideas that were shown, they kind of show the passive use of the river. I think in regards, as you mentioned, how we could get the most economical potential from the tourists in the river, I don't think any of these ideas really explore that. Because the examples that were shown, they show the pool, they show the kayaking, and I think that is how we can generate revenue, not just from people walking. Also, the light show, I think it's great, but as a tourist, you go there one day and you see it, and I don't see the point in maybe going there every night and check it out if it's changed. I think when you said in regards we should look at what we can offer tourists and how tourists come in the city, I think a lot of them come in Sherwood Cross Street, a lot of them come in Sherwood Carmel Street. So I think there's a great potential to explore maybe these ideas, these areas, and then to get them to the river. Nicholas shared has a kind of historical potential or the historical story. And I just think that the only kind of great idea of how the river was used is at the moment that the Get West office has moved to the, they're providing kayaking on the river. And I've done that myself, and it's amazing. And I feel like that finally some activity can be done on the river. And their office has been moved now to Nicholas Street, so I think that would be the way of tourists to find out what can be done on the river. So I think in regards to the river, maybe we should explore kind of rather from the activity and the revenue point of view rather than avoiding Nicholas Street altogether, because I think that's what the plan shows.
Hi, my name is Frank Larkin. Consensus city apart from others is the river flowing through it, and more particularly the Burrough Falls. There's no other city in this island or these islands that have the falls right in the middle, and that's something
we're doing. We're only the only city on the river.
Yeah, but even in the UK, you know, the, so, you know, that, that, yeah. You know, at this point that they haven't, you know, spoken about the Burrough Falls and how important they are. Just if I could just finish, I've heard some proposals to, you know, put a weir down near the docks or something, and, you know, to have it high tide at all times. I mean, that would be terrible in my view, because you've never seen the Corrigar Falls again, and there, but it's famous.
No, in this one, it was the existing.
No, I'm not saying there.
Oh, you're not.
I had a mic, I just said, and throw that in.
My name is Claire Jordan, I'm also with the Limerick Open Navigation Group. The aspect of tourism certainly isn't being cut in the way it could be. The potential is just certainly far more so than it should be by now. The point I'd like to raise is regarding the tourism accessibility to Limerick and the fact that you can't at the moment, and we'll address this in other avenues as well, but from a tourist side, you cannot access Limerick by water at the moment. Neither from the estuary or from the River Shannon directly from Jock Durham. So those are areas that maybe Fulcher Ireland could investigate, because you can't talk about bringing boats to Limerick at the moment. The second point is, you talk about the heritage and the experiences that people might enjoy in coming to Limerick. The aspect of Iron Crusher and the entry to Limerick by water is truly spectacular. It's the only place in Ireland that you can actually, to my knowledge, enjoy such an experience. Locals along here don't always know that experience. And the opportunity to advertise such as a unique experience in Ireland, by Fulcher Ireland, for the incoming tourist could be greatly overcome by being able to create that access. You have a cultural and heritage environment to investigate there. So I would suggest that that's an element that could be added to the experiences apart from the water itself.
And I'd like to pick up a few aspects on that, because that sounds wonderful. But if I'm a visitor, can I actually go there now?
No.
So there's a lot of potential work that has to be done.
No, tourists can be managed by you know, within the ESB. But again, that's a huge potential tourism opportunity. It's the first, our question is the first hydroelectric system to bring electricity to Ireland back in the 30s. So there's huge historical, as well as the engineering capabilities that were brought about, a 100-foot drop. It's a fantastic experience just as a tourism thing. And there are tourist operators who would be just thrilled to have the opportunity to bring that.
Okay, so I'm going to throw back in one sense in terms of if I'm a tour operator, to whom do I buy it from? So there are the things that we need to consider. Mm-hmm. Absolutely fantastic idea.
The ESB are actually working on it.
Sorry?
The ESB do have plans. I had a meeting with them on Monday. I just had to end the inspection. They are working on something, but again, it's who do they get it from? Who do they buy it from? How do we advertise it? Those issues all have been sorted out.
And so now you wants to take ownership or whether it's, you know, it's not thought of and don't own anything.
Oh, so, I'm worried about that. From a policy perspective, you have a hand to be able to drive something.
It has to be driven at a local level. So if there are consultations going on with the ESP at the moment, who then is working with them at a local level that wants to develop this product to put it into the shop window, that we can help them create that product to put into the shop window? But unless there's, we found this in other areas all over the country, and we have set up what we call local groups, and that will actually bring the product to life. We give them the assistance in bringing the product to life. That will enable them, the tour operators, to buy it. But unless there's a local group that are willing to take it on, look at it, see it develop, and work with us in Faltard to do it, it won't go any further.
I'm familiar with the development process.
Sorry, I actually got a group of tours from Slovakia, 10 of us, and I just called our next chat because I think it's an amazing picture. And they had a tourist guide, and they gave us, we just had to book in, they gave us a tour of 2 hours, and it was absolutely an amazing experience, and they showed us everything. So the tours can be pre-booked, they have people there who are taking care of the...
This
was a tour around the factory, which has a kind of historical importance and educationally important.
That's what it costs to tourism.
It is absolutely amazing.
Kind of start to bring the team together and start
creating
a product kind of, you know, an experience.
And we need to work with care and accounts on that, so that geography. And that's where it works fantastically then, and it's actually looking at it, pricing it, and then putting it into a package that can be consumed by the operators. And then we're working very closely with all of the councils all over the country in terms of developing the tourism product. That can go into the shop window. So once it's there, it's a fantastic idea. It's getting it to the next level that we're going to.
And just a word of criticism, her official bodies are either out of kilter with the realities. A prime example is of the tourist office, which was an after ski, moving to the city centre in O'Connell Street. But in the meantime, the private bus companies, after ski is the hub for all of the private companies now. There are more people boarding buses to get to Dublin Airport, to Killarney, Cork, Galway at Arthur's Quay than there are at the train station or the bus station. There's better connectivity there with 3 or 4 or 5 private companies getting people to Dublin Airport, getting them to Cork, getting them to Killarney, getting them to Galway. And at a time when this happens, the board of order, successively, moves the tourist office away from the hub uptown. It's one of the maddest things I've ever seen. And as a result, the new office, when I called in there this evening, was empty. One person and not a client there. Now, the previous office, to my mind, was equally hideous because you had a whole lot of wholesaling of leprechauns and everything that is disgraceful. I advocated before an ethnic cleansing of leprechauns.
I've gotten the leprechauns from the tourist offices, but I will bring back your point to my colleagues in remember that a lot of these conversations that are going on in terms of offices moving have maybe started about 4 or 5 years ago in terms of rental and all of that. So we have to move, and I will bring it back definitely to my colleagues in terms of...
The other matter is, we say, the other water activities which developed on their own were the coast, the sailboarding, not sailboarding.
Paddleboarding.
No, the surfing. Which developed in the zone and has been a godsend to coastal communities, we say Enniscrone and things like that, which gives you, and with wetsuits, it can be done almost all year round. Where previously seaside resorts had 3 months max tourism, now they can have 9 months of activity. Pass this on to her.
How much do you think it's important that tourism is developed by sort of promoting existing attractions, and how much it's down to maybe developing new attractions, maybe drawing on sort of the Wild Atlantic Way, what happened there, how much was development and promotion, how much was new?
Okay, so if you take, for example, kind of the Wild Atlantic Way, in one sense, We didn't invent anything because all the iconic attractions were there. The iconic attractions are the hook that we get the visitor in to visit places until new parks are established. So, say for example, we've done an awful lot of work down on the Chicago coast because of the province of Starbucks. And one of the things we're looking at is visitor experience down there. The hook is the Shkeli Light to get them in there. Unfortunately, it is 180 people can get there a day. But that's not kind of what the experience that the visitor will now get, because we're working with new product providers to develop new experiences that will make sure that the visitor will get the story of the Shkeli monks and get the stories of how the monks survived and lived in the landscape. So you're right, one of the ways of getting them in is possibly by, say, Kingston Castle here. So that would be a hope to get them in. They're iconic, they're here, they're in existence. But that's not to stop how new products can be put under the umbrella of that iconic attraction. So remember when I brought and my slide, kind of a destination will need to have one hero product at the heart of developing a competitive story. So you look at what is the unique attractor, but then you look at what are the subsequent products and services that can help you to get the visitor to stay longer, increase the development time, and increase the economic benefit. And we're constantly seeing and love to see that new businesses are opening up. What we need to find out is what are those new businesses and how and where can we purchase them. So what we're bringing in is the unique attractor, the hero product, but what they need to do is to find new experiences and have a blend of new and old experiences that will engage the senses of the visitor when they're here. And there's help there kind of in terms of doing that, kind of working kind of, you know, with the countries and ourselves in terms of, we have an awful lot of what we call season extension programs, kind of, you know, in how to develop your product and bring your product to market that is valuable.
We'll take one more before we go in. Eamon Connor.
We've been to an awful lot of meetings, an awful lot of meetings. We're withered from meetings, to be honest, at this stage. There's two elements that the whole discussion, really, tourism from a walker's point of view, or a cyclist's point of view, or a boater's point of view. And you really have to treat them separately at this stage, because there's so much to be done on the boating side that it's incredibly difficult to comprehend all of the problems. It would be actually good if the waterways and the water people could maybe talk together this evening, because the obstacles to boating are just, if you directed a person in a car to go to a destination and have the kind of obstacles that a boat user encounters trying to get through Limerick City, you'd be arrested for reckless endangerment of people's lives. Really, the Abbey River down here, anybody will tell you, it's extremely dangerous a lot of the times. An ordinary boat user should be able to come down to the doctor. People have told me they'd love to do it. There was a meeting in Tullamore there 6 weeks ago. A whole lot of boat people love to come down, go through Limerick, maybe stay in Limerick, go down the estuary. Forget it. They're afraid of it. They can't do it. It can't be done. Lock gates closed for 2 years. What's that about? People can't get through, and you know, we're talking about tourism on one hand, and you have the doors locked. It's just insane. The ESB have a job to do, we all understand that, but they are obliged by the statute that brought about their existence to provide navigation. They have to, it's the law. So they can't refuse to accommodate boaters. So they have to bring in a system that accommodates the boaters and make it work with the lock gates. And it's crazy that all these different state or semi-state bodies are talking in separate rooms about different things, and nobody's talking about the same thing at the same time. And the people here are extremely passionate about Limerick. I'm very disappointed in the way it's been treated so far. Very disappointed. They get half-baked plans that never refer to the reality of what is in Limerick and the potential that is in Limerick. And it really needs for the statutory organisations to talk to these people, really listen to them, listen to their suggestions, because multi-problems on the river have been caused by engineers, land-based engineers, who know nothing about water, currents, tides, seasons. completely ignoring both the advice, and then you have disaster. You have a marina that's constantly silted up, the lock gates closed. Last year, a 600-ton pontoon that was put in by the Waterways people at the end of the exit of the Abbey River was washed over the Weir Wall with 600 tons of weight, and it was anchored up to the stream bed at four places. And the current is so strong that it just lifted it up over the Weir Wall and left it hanging in space. So the engineers that designed that knew nothing. And
I think I'll stop you there, right?
Sorry, you designed it.
I may know from what we've heard, right? I've listened to that for about 5 minutes, right? Mm-hmm. Yes, Limerick has its problems with navigation, no doubt about it. The angular rest system you're talking about was 110 tons. It broke away because of the massive floods that the Shannon experienced, not through any failure in design or in its installation. No. I have to stop you, and the engineers that work in Waterways Ireland are qualified engineers who know what they're doing when it comes to working in the water. So I'd like to clarify that.
Okay, Okay, so I can tell you, we watched it for months, gradually moving closer and closer and closer to the Weir Wall before there was any flood. Well, you can shake your head, the reality was that's what happened. Anyway, there's no point in us two arguing about it. The reality of it is that the Abbey has to be made navigable. However, it was unmade. There are so many reasons it was unmade, but it has to be corrected. If you're talking about boating and tours, it just has to be done. And you really need to talk to the local rivermen, because they tried to talk to the engineers. They were ignored completely, and a lot of very bad results ensued from it. So we're not beating a drum here. We're just saying, talk to the people who are familiar with this every day.
I just say there, so that's something that we have been discussing like throughout the week actually, is the fact that we have to involve all of you guys, people that are using the river and people that have an interest in the river and a passion and a knowledge that we don't necessarily have. But this is something that, this is the first step in that process. We have you here in this room now. We've been talking to a lot of river users during the week, and we have this newly formed tourism unit within the council. And you're right, the council aren't the one body that are going to be able to make it work. We have to talk to the other stakeholders, one of them being the river users, the other people being Waterways Ireland, Failte Ireland, and the OPW. And there's probably some other bodies out there as well. We all have to come together and discuss this and just look at the solutions and ways that we can improve the navigation from a tourist point of view and from a river user's point of view.
Yeah. Well, I'll just finish by saying everybody in this room is very pro development, improvement, all of that, the positive things. Just because we've been frustrated by other things in the past doesn't mean we've lost the commitment to make Limerick better, and we do everything we can to help that.
I'm actually going to let Eanna get out of this presentation and I'll come back to you later, but just to say that we had a fantastic list of wishes and things that we will be taking back. I'm managing this project, so all of those things that have come forward over the week will be considered as part of the development of this project. So, Eanna.
Yes, so I'm just introducing Eanna while the presentation is getting ready. So, Eanna is the regional manager for the West of Waterways Ireland, and is the member of the senior management team of Waterways Ireland. Waterways Ireland manages, maintains, develops, and promotes over 1,000 kilometres of inland navigable waterways, principally for recreational purposes. Eanna is also a director of Leave No Trace Ireland, a member of the National Trails Advisory Committee, and chair of the Lakelands Initiative. So I'm just going to let Eanna come to this presentation. Thanks very much for joining us here tonight, Eanna.
That's all, and thanks a million for everybody who has turned up tonight. I think the turnout is full of positive passion that there is in Limerick about our waterways. Now, I'll make sure I get this ticker right. Okay, look, I'm not going through the heavy stuff. Our mission is our mission, and our vision is our vision. But what we want to do as a north-south body who looks after 1,000 kilometres of navigation on the island of Ireland is the provision of sustainable and accessible inland waterway recreational environment that provide compelling reasons for people to visit. So don't to manage and maintain the waterways to provide safe, open and accessible recreational space, inspire more people to discover and enjoy recreational activities, focus developments on unlocking opportunities. And again, look, if I'm restating what was stated by Failte, it's not by accident that we're doing that, because we are sister agencies working hand in glove with each other. And while we don't come at it from a purely tourism perspective, we come at it from a social dividend as well as economic dividend to those communities living along the waterways. So in the case of the Shannon, we have the longest river in the British Isles, British and Irish Isles, with a series of lakes and some lateral canals. Okay? It's about 250 kilometres of navigation, or 600 kilometres of navigation if you crisscross the lakes and so forth as well. There's a myriad of towns and villages, world-class boating infrastructure, numerous public sites, and very rich landscapes and heritage. And that is evident here in Limerick, in that, you know, when we think about it, the Shannon was the first motorway ever in Ireland. That's how people populated this Ireland, and in the 1800s, that's how we did commerce, and that's how we transported people. So again, just looking at the area that I manage from the tip of Loch Allen, right down to Limerick here, okay? And it's a large tract of the middle of Ireland, okay? And there's great access to it, if you think about it, with three international airports within a stone's throw, and great motorway access as well now to it, okay? What does the Shannon do? Well, it supports 8,500 private boats that are worth about €80 million annually to the private economy, the local economies here. There's 75% of the cruise hire trade is on the Shannon, and that's worth about another €55 million. In fact, Emerald Star, who had pulled out 18 boats out of its bases in Ireland and brought them over to the UK, are this year and next year reinvesting in new boating stock to bring it back to the level that it was. So that is proof positive that if a private company sees opportunities derive benefit from the waterways, it will invest in them. So this year and next year, there's about €3.5 million of investment being made by Emerald Star in their boating fleet to bring it back up. There's over 150 activity providers on the Shannon, and I think there's two here in Limerick. There's very rich pre-Christian, Christian and Napoleonic attractions right along the Shannon. I think that's another story that we would like to develop with Failte Ireland from a tourism perspective, in how we would link St. John's Castle to Athlone Castle, to Fort Eliza, and to all of those structures, but also how we would link the pre-Christian and the Christian. So we talk about Holy Island, for example, in Loch Ker, and I was listening with interest about Skellig and Skellig and how it's managed. And while it can only take 120 visitors a day if the weather is good, there's at least 10 times that number who go out on a boat and go around the Skellig. I've done it myself on a number of times. So there are opportunities there without actually stepping on to the sacred rock. The same could be done with the likes of connecting Holy Island to Clonmac Knives, to Quaker on Loch Ree, and up to Devonish. And there's a story, I think, that again would be of interest in the context of the Ireland Region East proposition that could be sold both domestically and internationally. The Shannon is turning into Ireland's outdoor playground in a lot of ways. There's a business running operating outside of Athlone in Hudson Bay, some of you probably know it, called Bay Sports. It attracted 48,000 visitors to what are bouncy castles on the water. Okay? 48,000 visitors, and those visitors arrived from May Bank Holiday to the end of September. Short enough window of operation, but they've grown their business from what started off with about 2,500 visitors to 48,000 visitors. And I can just show you the potential that is there in the waterways. We also have developed a new blue way, which, contrary to what some people might think here, is where you can dovetail sites. can work in harmony when they're planned for properly. And the other, the last thing I'd say about the Shannon, it is a proven tourism offering. Waterways Ireland and Failte Ireland jointly established an initiative called the Late Lands Initiative. It was supported by the 9 local authorities along the waterway. It's currently being reviewed within Failte, but it is a proven tourism destination that I think could stand as the fourth proposition within Failte. You'll have the Wild Atlantic Way, Ireland's Ancient East, Dublin, and a river proposition, a Shannon proposition. So what is the potential? Well, capacity, over the last 10 years when we had money, we doubled more capacity along the Shannon. We opened up new destinations, places for boaters to go, and we developed onshore services. There's 26 service sites along the Shannon where you can pull up in your boat. There's car parking if you want to go back to wherever you're from and come again the next day or 2 days later in your car. There's amenity sites, there's service blocks with toilets, showers, and in some instances we've dovetailed with the local authorities putting in playgrounds, tennis courts, outdoor swimming pools, and that kind of thing. So the ideas, not plans, the ideas that were shown earlier can certainly happen as long as they're planned and designed properly. Access, I mentioned the airport, the international air access. It's hugely improved for the Shannon with Terminal 2 in Dublin and the improvements in Shannon.
Yeah.
alternative is storing Victoria lock, the lock gates, that take 6,500 volts per annum in further up the channel. And there's the kind of service blocks we put in. Now, here's the crunch. In 2010, our budget for the Shannon, right, you can see there, was in the order of just over €4.5 million. Okay? Closer to five. What's happened since is on the non-pay side, on my maintenance budget, for the whole of the Shannon, it has been cut by 56%. So all those assets I was talking about earlier that we have to manage, I have 56% less money to manage them. And on the pay side, well, actually the pay side has gone down more again this year. On the pay side, I've lost 20%. In fact, I've lost 25% of the staff that were in the Shannon system to maintain those assets since 2010. So I've a lot less money to maintain it, and I've a lot less people to do the maintenance work. That's just facts. So how are we meeting the challenge? And this is where really the challenges are in ways insurmountable. We've rationalised our intervention. You see that here in Limerick. We have had, unfortunately, to rationalise our intervention through lock-keeping, that we can no longer provide a lock-keeper here in Limerick all the time.
You can provide a lock-keeper above Fortuna.
I can provide it on here. I have to have reorganized the labour, and that's exactly what you're saying. I have had to bring a general option from my depot in Port Tumnel down to Limerick to operate the lock
on Friday.
The second thing I've had to do is discontinue some programmes and some interventions. You mentioned earlier, one of your colleagues mentioned the fact that we have huge infrastructural issues here in Limerick. And I have them right along the waterway. I need to dredge here in Limerick. I've got €1 million worth of dredging that needs to be done in Limerick. I have about €600,000 worth of dredging that needs to be done in the Lacarra Canal. And I've got €200,000 worth of dredging that needs to be done in Bangor. So the problems that we face here in Limerick are similar to problems I face in other areas of the Shannon. There's not a doubt about it. And the other thing I've had to do is, with the reduction in the labour force that I have available to me, 25% of the staff that are gone, I've had to reorganise how we do our work. Where we had crews of four in various locations, I now have crews of two. Where I had a depot in Killaloe, it no longer exists. It's gone. So the closest depot that I have to this part of the Shannon is in Port Tumnel, and the closest depot I have to Lough Allen is in Roosley. So we've had to centralise our resource, reorganise our labour, and rationalise the intervention. So I need a load of resources. And this is where I need your support in lobbying and in persuading and cajoling government to provide additional resources to Waterways Ireland to maintain the existing infrastructure that we have and to pass on this national asset that is the Shannon to the next generation. So what are the resources I require? About 1.2 million extra per annum on the current side and about €2 million to invest in the capital stock, to invest in that dredging that I talked about, and to invest in the infrastructure that I talked about. So how do we close the gap? We're looking at three ways. Obviously, one is the government allocation. Another one is through income generation. We're going to have to look at how we provide this public service. It's just a matter of fact, or else we would not be able to provide And we also need to rationalise our interventions. We've rationalised our interventions, for example, here in Limerick, but also in Dublin, along the canals and up on the lower band. So the cuts that we face have been quite stringent. Horizon 2 is how we develop and expand. And again, from Waterways Ireland's perspective, on the navigation side, we lead it, but we look for third-party funding and we look for partners to do this with. So, for example, we've clustered that provision in places and we've managed to access third-party funding either through Failte or Ireland. development of the asset, the business support that was being talked about earlier, and how we can support and grow businesses on the waterway through industry interventions and supporting those networks. And again, we need resources. We need about €1 million per annum to do this. If we want to grow the business, that's Horizon 2. I think the duplication on these slides, sorry, now. Number three, then, and this goes back to some of the slides that were in Paul's presentation about how you create something new and bring additionality. And in a way, this is how you use the existing asset. And I think this is where Limerick can really play a role in opening up the waterways for people to get into them in an active and participatory nature. So this is this kind of blue ocean thinking, where you have to differentiate yourself from others. You open new market space, and indeed create a new demand. So it's a bit like Cirque du Soleil, where a circus and drama created a new product, and all of a sudden they have a new market. From our perspective, this is how we put navigation and boating with walking and cycling. And this is the blue way I was talking about earlier, up in the North Channel with 100,000 visitors. And this is where I think, in the short term, there's a potential to turn the attitude around walkways in Limerick to a positive attitude, to one where we can get people participating and engaged in the water. So in the development of the blueways, we have developed, using the towpaths and the land assets that we have, or in conjunction with the Eastern County Council, the ones that they have, we have developed 3 loop walks, 18 kilometres of cycling, and 200 kilometres of kayaking and canoe trails. Very small investment. In total, I think the 3 loop walks and the kayak trails cost us €48,000 to put in place. Okay, because the assets are already there. Okay? But what it has done is it has brought new visitors to the walkway. It has allowed people to get involved in a very active and participatory way in the waterways. And these could be new clients for the future for us, people who would then hopefully graduate from kayaking to renting a boat to owning their own. These are maybe our customers of the future. So the Blue Way is a lot more than just that. It's also about music and food and craft and arts and all of that. And I think, again, if you put that kind of concept with what you have already here in Limerick, I think the opportunities would be endless. I am not talking about the development of outdoor swimming pools in the middle of the navigation, but I am talking about being smart in how we can open up access to the entire, by way of walking and cycling, to the perimeter of the waterways, and also about how we can create more activity-based businesses in the waterway. So how do we grow the business? Look, we've to secure the resources, that's the first thing. We've to manage the existing, maintain the infrastructure, develop new, and create new. So we have a good bit done. We've achieved much from as a navigation. We have gone backwards in the last couple of years too, though. But in the 10 years previous to that, we doubled the mooring capacity on the channel. We opened up new destinations. And in fact, Limerick, following the work that was done on the Weir, it was open again for navigation. That has gone back considerably in the last couple of years. But I would hope that we would make that leap again and be able to open up Limerick properly to navigation in the coming years. We've built and strengthened the offering, the destination and the proposition, and we've done that with the likes of Failte. And we've delivered on the benefit. €88 million from private boating into the local economy, €55 million from cruise hire, €4.4 million from the small bit of blue way that we've developed. So I think that the payback by government investing in us is paid back handsomely to the economy through that. So the prize, and this is what we want in Waterways Ireland, and one that I hope that could be shared, is that the Shannon navigation could be the foundation to put Ireland on the map as an outdoor destination. Thanks a million, and there's my...
Thank you.
lack of resources and the reduced resources is an issue in Fáilte, Ireland. And bearing that in mind, I mean, you know, Fáilte, Ireland, sorry, Waterways, Ireland. we all have resources. But I suppose Waterways, Ireland, in terms of their role in navigation, you know, we can use their expertise and we do want to continue this conversation. But just bear in mind that Waterways, Ireland aren't going to be able to solve a lot of solutions, but they can provide an expert advice and opinion to help us out on that way. So, thanks.
Colin Byrne from the Global Navigation again. I would like to have one question. Do you accept any knowledge from your presentation you appear to, but I'd just like to hear a bit more clearly that, you know, if you're not meeting your vision and mission statement with regard to Limerick and your objectives and so on, you accept that?
I accept that.
I mean, I started using River when I was 14, 15, 12, you know, at that age, and, you know, what we have today is significantly more than what I had 40 years ago, so there has been influence, it's no discussion. But I think the people of Limerick, and not in particular, feel that at the moment, Waterways Ireland are famous in Limerick for all sorts of reasons. Okay, and of course, one of those is budgetary. And, you know, we, maybe Claire and I and the team here, we are in the process of starting some activism to try and lobby our councillors and our TDs and our whoever to try and rectify that. So we are starting that. We haven't done it yet. We're just starting. So we do intend to try, but it would be, it would be useful to hear from you what you need from us in terms of getting the ammunition to be able to get those resources. Resources are not limitless, but I think we can all accept that the Waterways of Waterways Ireland have failed Limerick in terms of what we have available here. I don't know if anybody else has anything else to say.
If I could just answer that in this way. Waterways Ireland had a budget of €35 million to manage 1,000 kilometres of waterway and to open up new destinations and to develop the navigation of products. That €35 million never enough. Because we were asked to open the Royal Canal to navigation, which is a canal, if those that are boaters would know it, runs from Dublin through the Midlands and connects in with the Channel in North County Longford. We were never given the resources to maintain it after it was built. Crash happened and the cuts came. So we have had to make very difficult choices with regard to our navigation. And in fact, one of the choices that as a senior management group that we were considering for this year, given the budget constraints that we're in, was to reclose the Royal Canal in its entirety to navigation. Now, unfortunately, we were able to avoid that through other measures. But we have had to restrict navigation here in Limerick for the last 2 years, given the budgetary constraints. And let's call a spade a spade. There were 71 lock passages through Sarsfield Lock in 2015. I had 8,500 lock passages through Albert Lock last year. I have lost my lock keeper in Albert Lock as well as Limerick. Right? So 8,500 passages with 4 people on average per boat is a lot of customers that we are failing in Albert Lock as well.
I would just point out that going to the lock is not the main issue, not the only issue here. And that's why there is only 80 passages through the lock.
Yeah.
Because coming down to Limerick through the Eanna River and all of the difficulties of the water flow rate and so on and so forth make it virtually impossible or very difficult for inexperienced people to never do it. And, you know, even the experienced people have difficulty doing it.
And
so that issue needs to be addressed.
Through our companies have included their customers.
So the issue of the Eanna River needs to be addressed before the lock openings will increase because of all the rest.
Again, in regard to what Colin's always suggested, that we're aware of the resource issues and we're aware that it's only through lobbying and the various cooperations that we've done, both locally and at a national level. But I would just make the point that if you go back to Shannon data presentation slide, in reference to your numbers of I don't have the percentage, but it would be a very high percentage impact. Do you want to listen to Mr. Local?
Yeah.
I'll just shout. The point is that if you look at those numbers and you refer them back to Josephine, sitting here as well to Ireland, everybody's advertising come to Ireland. So with that 75% of all that 55 million money that you're talking about, it never comes to Limerick. The reason being that the rental companies are not actually allowed. The renters are barred from their rental contract to bring a boat past Killarney Bridge.
Yeah.
They will not come to Limerick. They're not allowed to. So it's literally only the private boat user who feels secure, experienced, with the relevant local knowledge as well provided to actually dare come down past Killarney Bridge.
Yeah.
And I use the dare word advisedly there.
And it's not the only area on the channel that cruise car fleet are precluded from bringing their boats.
I agree. But given that if this is all about bringing the opportunity of the water in Limerick to life more than it currently is, it's somewhat stagnant, you could say. Your 55 million, not a penny that comes to Limerick in reality.
Yeah.
And your activity providers, yes, there might only be two, possibly three, if there's a room like that could come down through the archbishop, two or three providers. You're not going to get the potential to grow that until that system is sorted out. And so if I look at the point that there's been talks that because of the tourism potential, EU money was sourced, but Ireland, Council, etc., are all very busy in getting money together. Use some of that money to support Waterways Ireland and what they need to do for the benefit of them.
Just for us doing the information, about 6 years ago, a similar group met over in City Hall. So, Darren Winston, who was the engineer, he brought a lot of boat clubs together, most boat clubs, fishing clubs, walking clubs, and out of that came 20 boats. And I have to say that Waterways Ireland were central to all of the proposals, every one of them, because it was good. The first one that we came back with was Johnson House Hotel, just up there on the canal. It was owned by Waterways Ireland. Our group, Poison River, approached them, and we said we'd like to use that and like to get local youngsters involved in refurbishment. They agreed. They've handed it over to City Council. That's the first one that Waterways Ireland did. Talking about the navigation of the Eanna River, we brought Eanna was at the meeting, Donald was at the meeting, Chairman Sullivan. We asked about the navigation of the Eanna River, which is a disaster, we know. But when I was a kid, you could go around Rowe, Ireland, as you all know, and probably both as long as yourself there. And Waterways Ireland have agreed to the silt around that. So now if you go around the Eanna River, or if you come around Rowe, Ireland, you're facing down the Eanna River, and there's no no doubt that. I can go back up to the Donald's Field, where there's a clan marina with LIT, 6 acres of land has come to the council. Again, Waterways Ireland was sent into that. And then we approached to our group for two pillars to be taken off the weir above here to make navigation down through, for only a certain amount of hours, obviously, through the saddle weir above. And again, Waterways Ireland. Now, I can keep going on because it sickens me a bit to hear, because I'm after looking at what Waterways Ireland do, and I can understand the frustrations of people not being able to go down, but I also understand the reality of what's going on, because I have nothing but praise for what Waterways Ireland would do, and I'm surprised that you didn't mention all the positives. And by the way, this is just a bit of a document that Magella has. These propositions that we have went to France, didn't it?
Yeah.
For funding through Limerick City Council, through General Sullivan and the rest of them. So put these forward. And they're going on as we speak. And just what I'd like to say is that if you want to know what's going on, don't be so diverse. We shouldn't be waiting all the time for meetings like this. We should be talking. We should be meeting.
Yeah.
There's so many people in Limerick that haven't talked. So I walked up the road the other while ago, the fellas I go with, and I nearly had to walk across to the other side of the road. But if arriving at any demand, can't perceive the right to be wrong, I suppose I deserve it, because I think the bridge is brilliant, but that doesn't mean that I don't like the fellows who disagree with it. But that's the reality of it. In this city, if you disagree with somebody, there's something wrong with you. Anyway, that's my talk for the day. Thank you.
Sort of picking up on what you said, but I think any of you might be able to answer it. And it's just in relation to what you said about kind of the Lakelands and whether Limerick would really, Limerick City would fit with kind of the Lakelands. Because obviously the river here is tidal, it's not like Loch Derry or Loch Ree or other parts of the Shannon. So I'm just wondering if Limerick City would fit in as a Lakeland destination. We're not wild enough for the Wild Atlantic Way or east enough for Ireland's ancient east. And we're obviously not Dublin, so I'm just wondering, would we really fit in with the Lakelands? That's my first question.
Well, I think there's a review ongoing at the moment in terms of the Lakelands proposition, so let's see what comes from that. But I think you're in a very unique kind of position here yourself. I come up from Cork City, are saying they're not on the Wild Atlantic Way, which is the gateway to the Wild Atlantic Way. And if you look at the visitors when they're coming in, where do they stay? The majority of them are staying here. In their city, and they use it as a gateway onto the Wild Atlantic Way. So you should be kind of, and that's where Limerick would come into play in terms of what it has to offer the visitor, its own unique, compelling kind of proposition, kind of, you know, and the experiences that it has. And that's what would be put into the shop window, and that's what the visitor would see. So in terms of that, it's one of the experiences that you have available for the visitor, and you're in, kind of, you're hitting on each one. Of the kind of the three grand experiences that are there presently, and even kind of with the Shannon in terms of the inland waterways. So let's remember that you're in a very unique position and you have some very unique offerings that are here. So the visitor, when they're overseas, they don't really kind of, they will hear of the brand the Wild Atlantic Way, they will hear of the brand Ireland's Ancient East, and they will hear of the brands. But when they start to investigate and do their online research, and remember, that's what visitors will do prior to going and booking any destination that they want to go to. So you need to be populating kind of in terms of what there is to do and see in them. And it's the experiences that will bring the visitor here. Once you go to the brands and you're at the gateway, you have accommodation that is here. They will always stop here, whether they're or in terms of the east, going out onto the coast, they've done for years, and they will continue to. Would give them the reason to stay longer than here.
Actually, my second question is really a follow-up to that. It's yes. Just the Blue Way stuff sounds fantastic. I'm just wondering, are there current plans or even early discussions about Blue Way for Limerick?
Yeah, there are. I've been talking to Limerick City Council, the community department side, and the age to like some Bray and others here about how we can do that. And you know, I think because of all of the confluence of all of the waterways and some disuse of waterways and the work that has been done by Smarter Travel, for example, and how you link into the Rhino Classic Canal and UL and right up using the embankments that the ESB have built, that there's an opportunity there to develop a network or net place of walking and cycling provision along the water, even if it is a disused canal, right? It's off-road and it's trying to put it in safe. Right? And then on the water, with minimal investment, you can develop kayak and canoeing trails and facilities for stand-up paddle boarding. And the beauty of Limerick is you can have different grades of water. I think some people here will understand what I mean about grades of water. So you can have white water in some places, still in that water and others. So you can have your novices in one area, and you can have those who want to join in the rush and others. And it feeds into the connected families and into the social energizers categories that fall to have. So yes, we are talking, but it's talking, it's ideas at this stage.
And can I add to that, we've done it as well, kind of I've worked with Cork City Council and Ventry Harbour as well. So kind of Limerick's operation kind of on the sea as well as in the river. And what is really, really interesting in terms of the development
where can I find the local crafts kind of, you know, because if you're in
anything, where can tourists spend money when they get off the bus by the King George Castle?
So,
and how are they navigated to go to the city? I mean, I've seen them lost. They don't know where to go.
But that's all we find.
Oh, yeah.
We're just thinking and talking in terms of the ways. This is the kind of one of the ways that visitors have. And I suppose here, you're in a very unique position because you have for both the soft adventure and you have a hard adventure. So you're linking it to kind of, you know, the, you're touching, you probably have here kind of the different levels and grades that you won't have in many places, and it's on your doorstep. So on, in, the beauty of it is that there's a lot of these kind of looking at them, because that's daytime.
Yeah.
Nighttime as well, so it's your night on the river. So, you know, go out to use that.
Yeah. Rowe set up the garden beginning of the city is back to run the local suggestions from local people. Just by way of declaring that all the fields in that regard.
And is that truly
on that river? Just a few hundred yards away from here, it's supposed to be born up there. Most of my youth, particularly my misspent youth, was spent on the Shannon, the Battle River, and the Main, then the Main Shannon. And in fact, I'll have you all know that I won a cup at the Abbey Regatta several years ago. And indeed, I did it on both of them, was owned by this man's father. Okay? So I think that qualifies me for being local. Now, I think this is a great event. We should be going on about it. I think it ties in. This is not places. There's a massive future for the day. Our authorities now are not backing the finish of the great ideas, a lot of ideas, a lot of criticisms of the day or declarations of shortcomings that need to be addressed. I'm not going to suggest any ideas for the simple reason that the risk is not negative. I have to give you all a very, very serious warning. Yes, the river channel is our greatest asset. Where else would you get it? We're the luckiest city in Ireland and in the river. No other city has such a fantastic facility out there. And we need to mind it, develop the ideas, but do it sustainably at the same time. But the warning is this. We have this professor, but we have to protect it. There is a massive threat looming to the river channel that could transcend all of what we're really discussing here tonight. I'm with the River Channel Protection Alliance. Dublin City Council have put some on the table to construct a massive pipeline from Parson Basin to Dublin to extract 330 million litres of water per day to deliver it to Dublin, diverting River Shannon water to Dublin. Now, the problem is we have to look at the realists. The realists will know that it will never, ever stop at that. They come along next year and they want to. I will know that we did before this year. And next year, the same thing, and so on. And this kind of abstraction can destroy the River Shannon. It can make the River Shannon. We talked here about navigation, and you both of you talked about navigation. If this scheme goes ahead, incidentally, it's not really about confidence at the moment. If this scheme goes ahead, the levels of water in the River Shannon will drop. Even today, before anything like this, and I was in the movement, I'm told that most summers, when the weather is dry, the falls of Ireland are an issue occasionally, warnings.
of low levels. That is what happens with navigation. There's even a greater one than that. We have been written to by the Admiral of the German Estuary. He has responsibility for safety of navigation from this bridge out here, right down to the draw line across from Lupin to Carriet. And he expressed great concern at the levels of abstraction that were being contemplated. And he put it this way to us in general. He was concerned at the levels because we rely on the fast flow of water at ebb tide. If there isn't sufficient flow, the ship channels will sit up. If that happens, ships will not reach the report. Now, this is a matter of authority. Every side is nobody. But this is a man of authority making such statements. So, I'm asking all of you, for God's sake, be aware of this, because it will affect. You can do all the planning, you can do all the instructions, and bring all the ideas, but if you don't have sufficient flow of water, it's all for nothing. The second point was this. These proposals have been forensically examined by a very, very capable legal mind, and an expert in these things, an expert in forensics. And it has been established very clearly that there is no need for this pipeline. The pipeline is so big as that you can stand up inside the pipeline. It's a 1200 millimeter there is no need for it. Dublin doesn't need it. All the raw water it needs and always has had, it just allowed the water treatment facilities to deteriorate over decades of neglect and underinvestment. So close to half the water is draining into the ground. If they take the shallow water from here, that's exactly what will happen. To that shallow water. We rely on us, Dublin would be the gain, and we rely on us of it, and we're sick and tired of this east-wide divide, the Dublin establishment at the east coast, again, having primacy. They took shallow water from us, and gave it to the DAA, and proceeded about the Shannon Airport ground until recently. We snatched it back again, and now the Shannon is sorry. Now, one final question. I'd like to know, particularly if Waterways Ireland and Port Ireland, who are working together, have you a position on this? Have you engaged in it?
Basin, and we have said that they need to guarantee the minimum
does turn out that they're taking more than they initially stated, what can you do about it then?
We have a piece of legislation which we would then use to bring them to court if they do not guarantee the minimum navigational depth in the Shannon Navigation Act, going back to the
age. Say that to the public?
Yes.
William O'Connor, who's an environmental scientist who has a business here in Limerick, he stated, what goes down the old River Shannon is just barely enough, and in fact, technically below the level, below the depth level, to allow migratory fish to get up the
shaft. I'm not an expert.
But there's 10 cubic going down. It has to come into the equation, because if you drop that even more, which will happen, then no fish will get up.
Get good.
the estuary, but they can't come up. There's solutions, like with the dredging, there's solutions for that as well. And with the lock, if you had visitor moorings below, you could get, and maybe lock up sometimes when there's rugby finals there. They used to go to Wales to the rugby matches before, you know. So that's another huge attraction.
Just about the, I'm aware that there's a bottleneck between a bottleneck and below, but the estuary itself, regardless of the thing, the problems here at the city, there's a great need to. Right, you've got Foyne's Yacht Club and you've got Killaloo Marina, but there are lots of piers along the estuary, say Ringmoylan, Bedcastle, Kiltiri, Lynn, and things like that. But loads of those are silted up, and I think with use, with the silting would go away. But there is a facility. There are facilities there that should be. Made brought to the attention of boaters, and there is a use being made at the moment with jet skis. Lots of people might not like it, but they're beginning to use air. They're beginning to use the water, which hasn't been used for quite a long time. And there, again, you have the whole expanse of the Fergus estuary with its islands and archaeological remains. And it's a pity that more activity isn't taking place in the lower estuary. And the other thing about Limerick as a port, I think when Limerick talks about its tonnage, it's talking about estuary tonnage. Only a knobwood comes up to Limerick Port, and it would be much better if it was used as a leisure facility rather than a commercial facility. Everything stops at Foyne's because it takes an extra day from Foyne's up to Limerick and another day going down. So it's Foyne's, the coal station down at Money Point, fuel at the fuel farm channel, but the it's the odd stray road to Limerick City. So it would be much better used as a leisure facility.
Impact of the British Cabinet on the
river? That's a really good question. As an answer, why? No, it's a really, it's one that we are grappling with, along with the Irish government and the executive that's now not functional in the North. So, it may be possible. Understand the way we're funded. Okay? 85% of our funding comes But I agree with you, there is no toilet block.
2 hours, I only get 2 minutes.
I know.
So hang on.
Yeah.
So, what about that? I know there's more services there. It needs to be dredged, just call it
a million. €1 million worth, yeah.
There's no cruisers that go in there. It's full of boats at the moment. If a boat comes in or down, if it comes down for a day or two, we have that much problem there.
Gateway to the Shannon. It's our front door. Yeah. We had him here last Friday, it was advertised and we had him go to Lock Passage.
Well,
but the boat, no, he only said he was running north on a Thursday.
No, that's not true.
Traditionally, it moves onto the river, and that's what those plans are doing.
my main point is that these meetings need to continue, and there needs to be expression from the river people as well.
The first point I want to make, one is about if sludge is a hazardous material, perhaps, and it should be, if you have to get rid of it, maybe it should be used to cover the red mud so that sludge from the river bed, silt, could be used to cover up the heap of toxic dust in down the estuary. Which
I don't go beyond that bridge.
It seems because you need to cover it and then grow properly.
Please leave your comments. We have come and keep that, and we have one last event tomorrow morning. We have the generation workshop, and we're going to be event.